Actually, it's Natchitoches. I only want to make one small correction, but my professors at the University of Kansas would insist that I do. Actually, my PhD is from KU, not K-State. There was a song that was very popular when I was a young man that went basically, Kansas City, here I come. There's some crazy little women there, and I'm gonna get me one. Well, I brought my crazy little woman with me today. My wife, actually, of 46 years, and I want to express my appreciation to her for coming and being here today. It's awfully early to appear for a lecture, I know. So, what I want to talk about today, whoops, that's not me. My lecture's going to be very short if it's on that subject. This is the subject of my presentation today. To do that, I'm going to really cover these subjects. I'm going to modify this slightly based on the comments of Professor McMeekin to give a few more words on the Franco-Russian alliance and the start of the war for France. But each and every one of these topics, I really will spend more time on the general topic of planning the strategy for the war than I will on the actual conduct of the war. I will say also that in the 20 years I was in the Department of History, we had many captains and majors that I would call them PowerPoint Rangers because they could make PowerPoint sing in all sorts of ways. I can't. We may have a few difficulties today. We'll see as we go along with this presentation. The first thing to begin when you look at France in World War I is to look at the casualties. This is a graph from a book called Annuaire Statistique. It is published by the Service Historique in France, and it shows the casualties by month from the first month of the war through the last month of the war. The first high point that you see over there is August, September 1914. And as you go across by years, if you see in 15, that first elevation of casualties is the Artois offensive. And then the second elevation is the Artois-Champagne offensive. And then in 1916, those are the various battles of Verdun. Going into 1917, that peak is Nivelles offensive. They take more casualties in offensives than they do in defenses. And then going across to 1918, that first one, in fact, is the Battle of the Marne, and the second one really is the final drive into Germany. But look at that. They will take about 165,000 casualties, and this is losses during the war, disappeared, or prisoners. A great scandal after World War I is France really did not know how many men it had lost in the war. Young men would report to conscription centers. Their family would take them there in some cases, and then the family would hear nothing about them. They don't know if they got to a unit, if they died in training, or if they disappeared somewhere else. And after the war, they tried to track down those people and tried to come up with a clearer statement of those casualties. But in that month, of all those months of August and September, they're going to take about 165,000 casualties a month. They have a population of 38 million. The United States during that period had a population of about 78 million, double that. If the United States had taken that level of losses in World War I, we would have lost more than 300,000 each month during that period. That would be 600,000 casualties. We took 400,000 casualties in World War II. So you're talking about a level of losses that really is not part of the American experience at all. Excuse me. Now, when we look at France and think about what they did in 1914, you always have to think Franco-Russian alliance. Always Franco-Russian alliance. And this map suggests that in the sense of all the blue against all the red. French strategy, French tactics, French everything is based on Franco-Russian alliance. That alliance is completed 1890, 1892, 1893. And throughout that, the French organization, manipulation, whatever you want to call it, always returns to Russia. And it's based on the idea of an attack from Russia into Germany and an attack from France into Germany. Without that simultaneous attack, the French really feel they cannot defeat Germany. If you look at their actual thought and their planning, the first time they think about an offensive against Germany is after the conclusion of the Franco-Russian alliance in 1892. Even then, all the plans from 1892 until 1910 are basically for a defensive followed by an offensive. It's not until 1910, 1911 that the French really say we should do an offensive. The other thing that's important, and I'm going to add this based on Professor McMeekin's comments this morning, is the importance of Serbia. In 1912, the French General Staff do a study for Poincaré. After the Moroccan crisis, he's traveled to St. Petersburg. He comes back, realizes that there are numerous problems in the Balkans, and he asks the General Staff, what will be the effect of a war that comes out of Serbia in which Austria invades Serbia? And this is published in the Documents Diplomatiques after the war. The General Staff very firmly says this will provide an opportunity to redraw the map of Europe. This is a scenario that they thought about, that they planned on, that they wanted to appear. And then in July 1914, when that scenario appears, it's just like all the ducks in a row. This is the perfect scenario for France to get involved in a war in Europe. Why? For the simple reason that the Austrians are going to leave forces in Galicia, but they're going to have leave forces down here. So ultimately, they will have fewer forces involved. It'll be a better chance for Russia to succeed and really to carry out its part of this attack into Berlin. The second thing that is important is goes back to the Franco-Russian alliance, this number of 800,000. Again and again, the French chief of staff will meet with the Russian chief of staff, and they will talk about what they're going to do, what the Russian commitment is. And early in the discussions, the Russian will commit to 800,000 troops against Germany. Where does that number come from? All of you who've worn a uniform have been at these sort of meetings. Somebody has eaten lunch, and they got a tablecloth there, and they'll say, well, looks like the Russians can put about half their forces toward Austria-Hungary and about half their forces toward Russia. How many forces do they have immediately available? About 1.6 million. What's half of that? 800,000. That 800,000 becomes written in stone, and again it is repeated when the chiefs of staff of France meet with the chiefs of staff of Russia. Ultimately, in August 1914, the Russians will not put 800,000 troops there. They will, in fact, put about 350,000 troops. So the number that came from wherever it came from, right out of somebody's rear end, is the number that they really debate during the peaceful period. So the Franco-Russian alliance is the foundation of French planning. When you think about their emphasis on the offensive, you can think offensive outrance, you can think grand maison, but you got to start out with Russia, because there's going to be an attack by Russia and there's going to be an attack by France. This is the double attack. Now, but when you look actually at the terrain of France, this is a map from my book, Pyrrhic Victory. This is the boundary of France. This is Luxembourg. This is going across. This is Givette. You come up to the Meuse River, the Sambre River, and then it extends out here. In the post-1871 period, they will build the Serre de Rivière fortifications. I showed those here on the blue line. Please don't see that line of fortifications as something like the Maginot Line. It's much more like something like Verdun. You're familiar with Verdun and the fortifications that are there. That's what they do at Verdun to a more limited degree at Toul, at Epinal, and also in Belfort. But they put those fortifications there, and then they look at what they call truets, or gaps. There's a gap down here. The Germans could come here. There's the Charmes Gap in the center. There's the Stenay Gap, and then there's the Chimay Gap, also called the Oise Gap. Now, I'm very familiar with the Stenay Gap because of all the work I've done on France in 1940. When the Germans attack in 1940 with the 19th Panzer Corps, Panzergruppe von Kleist, they will come out of Echternach toward Diekirch to Neufchâteau. They will turn into Bouillon, and they will go into Sedan. The 10th Panzer Division from the 17th Panzer Corps will come a little south of that, go to Arlon, will go a little deeper, and then come out here. This is a wide open area, not wide open around Neufchâteau, but wide open south of that. This is clearly an avenue of approach in which the Germans could use it to come into France. Now, the interesting thing about Chimay Gap is how do you get there? Well, you get there basically the long way here. They really don't put any planning into the idea that the Germans will come through what became known as the Gimbeloux Gap after 1919. Gimbeloux is a town right in here, and it's the focus of their planning after 1919. Why? Because that's where the German main attack came in 1914. But when they're doing the planning before 1914, what they are concerned about is a drive across here, either turning into Stenay, a drive across here, turning into the Chimay Gap. Now, in terms of actual offensive versus defensive, the emphasis on the offensive starts in 1910. They have someone who is the vice president of the Superior Council of War. He is the designated commander in the event of war. He is not the chief of staff of the army because they have separated, the French political leaders have separated that out. They don't want another Napoleon, so they separate the administrative function from the command function. They don't even create field armies. They designate the commanders, and after war, then they will form those units. But Michel is the designated commander of the end of war in 1910, and he looks at what can happen. He wants an offensive, and he says, we ought to attack up here through, they didn't call it the Gimbeloux Gap, but through the Gimbeloux Gap. And his idea was to form something they called demi-brigades, one regiment of active forces, one regiment of reserves. If the balloon went up, as we used to say, you'd combine these two, and then you'd go to war. Well, there were lots of problems with that. First of all, they can't go into Belgium, or at least can't announce going into Belgium, because Belgium is neutral. If they do that, they're going to lose the support of Great Britain. They're going to lose the possibility of Italy joining them. So one of the general officers who attended this briefing where Michel tries to sell his idea says, it's loony. It is loony. No chance of approval in the operational sense, the strategic sense, or the political sense. So they get rid of Michel, and they bring in his successor. Who can be his successor? First person they look at is General Powell, a distinguished soldier, lots of experience. Powell at first says, if I'm going to be the designated commander, I get to pick the senior generals. They say, nope, you're not the winner. Then they look at Gallieni, famous colonial soldier, and say, what about you? Well, Gallieni says, well, I took part in getting rid of General Michel, and I don't think I should benefit from that, so I declined the choice. Then they turn to this not obscure general, but not as well known, Joseph Joffre. Joffre ultimately is picked, But Joffre is an interesting man and far more complex than what some English language sources have suggested. First and foremost, he is an engineer. And those of us who deal with engineers regularly know they think differently, they conceive of problems differently, they come up with solutions differently, especially different from those who concentrate on the humanities. But he is an engineer. He performed well in Indochina. He performs well in Formosa. He performs well in lots of different environments. He is the in command, almost by default, of a group that goes to Timbuktu in Africa. He comes out of that experience as the hero of Timbuktu. He is well known. He is sent to Madagascar to be Gallieni's engineer, putting fortifications in there. And then during that process, he goes back to Paris for a visit. As soon as he gets back to Paris, they glom onto him, make him, give him several positions. First of all, command of an artillery brigade. Then they make him the director of engineers. Gallieni's able to get him back for a little while. And then he goes back to Paris. He soon commands an infantry division. Surprise, surprise, it's an infantry division in downtown Paris. He then commands a corps that's just north of Paris. Bottom line, he's very well connected politically. He's very attuned to politicians' demands. One of his fellow officers said he's like a crab. He always moves to the left. So, but the perception of him is that he's a very malleable, very easy to control individual. Push comes to shove, they're going to find he's exactly not that kind of person. But Joffre comes in 1911. He becomes the generalissimo, the vice president of the Superior Council of War. They pass executive decrees that bring together the functions of chief of staff of the army with the vice president of the Superior Council of War, the designated commander in times of war, and Joffre has more authority, more power than any chief of staff or any senior general in French history other than in time of war. And he starts reforming this French army in lots of different ways. He is not only an engineer, he's a railway guy. He's a railway guy. One of his duties while he was serving in Paris was to do the military part of the railway. So one of the first things he does is practice moving troops from northeastern France to Paris up toward the west. They do two rehearsals of that. They're aided by the fact in France, all railways go to Paris. They sort of come in like spokes. In 1892, they improved that system by connecting the various spokes. So it did look like a wheel, but there are lines connecting in there. But Joffre is a railway guy. He is one of the few people who's ever worn a uniform who knows anything about railroads. Once he gets into his position, he will do a number of things. He will revise French regulations. He will put more emphasis in those regulations on the offensive. They'll rewrite their small unit regulations. Field manuals is what we call them in the U.S. Army. And then they revise their field manuals for large units. He will direct several autumn maneuvers. And one of the things they do is test new technology, meaning aircraft. They really get some interesting insights into aircraft and have plenty of aircraft by the time the war starts. But he also revises the war plans, which brings us to Plan 17. When Joffre became the chief of the general staff in 1911, the first thing he did was look at the existing plan, Plan 16, and modify that plan. What did he do? He will move active forces from the south here to the north, and he will move some reserve forces to the south. What he does with Plan 16 is get a balanced force. So if the Germans attack in the Alsace region, he can respond there. If the Germans come through Belgium, he can attack there. He will also launch the work on Plan 17. Now, if you don't remember anything else from my presentation today, remember Plan 17 is not a war plan. It is not a war plan. It is a concentration plan. Why is it a concentration plan? Because in 1912, Joffre went to the Superior Council of War, which was a group of political leaders, as well as a few military leaders, and said, I'd like to go into Belgium in the event of war. And they come back with a resounding no, you cannot go back, you cannot go into Belgium before the Germans in the event of war. If you go into Belgium before the Germans, we will lose the support of Great Britain, and we may lose Italy in the same thing. So Plan 17 is not going to do anything about moving forces into Belgium. What it will do is it will give, this is the traditional depiction of Plan 17. It comes from the West Point Atlas of American Wars. There's some serious errors in this, but it's got the basic portrayal in the sense of First Army is going to concentrate here, Second Army is going to concentrate here. Here is Luxembourg, here's the border going up, here's Givet, and then of course here is the boundary between France and Germany. This is Metz, a fortification that the Germans have added to and reinforced. This is Thionville, another fortification of the side of the same. They put Ruffy in Third Army, put him in a central position really to watch Metz and Thionville. They put Fifth Army out on the left. This is too far out on the left. In fact, Fifth Army is in reality in about this this area. And then they place the Fourth Army in the rear. Fourth Army is their flexible arm. If the Germans come through this area, then Fourth Army is going to come over here next to First and Second Army. If the Germans are going to come through Belgium, then Fourth Army is going to go up into the between the Third and Fifth Army. But this is a plan, and it's focused on the same era that we're talking about before. It is designed to give the commander flexibility. It is designed to allow the French to go south or to allow them to go north. Now, in the plan, Joffre gives the army commanders some geographical areas to look at. First Army, Saarbrücken into the south. Second Army, Morhange, ultimately Saarbrücken. Third Army, Longwy in this area. Fifth Army, Arlon, Neuchâteau, Quimet. Those are just marks on the ground or objectives that they could be given. The thing to remember on this, though, is that the goal of France, of Joffre's strategy is not those terrain objectives. His goal is force on force. He wants to destroy the German army when it attacks into France. To understand that, look at the key dates on this portrayal of the Battle of the Frontiers. They're going to put up covering force up on July the 30th. They're going to mobilize on August the 2nd. August the 7th, they're going to send a corps raid. I'll show you that in a moment on a map. On the southern part below First Army into Mulhouse. This is nothing more than a way to show the French people that he's serious, that France is involved in this war. He wants to build up some enthusiasm. I'll talk about that in a second in terms of whether he's successful. The second is on August the 14th. This is 1st and 2nd Army. They're going to be unleashed into Alsace. And then on August the 21st, 23rd, this is the 3rd and 4th Armies going into Belgium. Now, if you look at this actually on the ground and think about the intelligence part of it, you have some real questions about Joffre's planning. First Army down here is going to do the Mulhouse in here. Second Army here. Third Army is going to be split into the Army of Lorraine and Third Army. Army of Lorraine will have responsibility for really watching over Metz and Thionville. And then 4th Army is going to be moved into the line here. The French are absolutely confident that the Germans are coming to France first. That intelligence is corroborated by the Russians. And he will move 5th Army out here in case they come as far as Givet. In other words, through the Chimay Gap. Now, what kind of war are they thinking about? Answer to that can be found right here in this little place called Brie, the Brie Basin. That contains almost all the iron ore that France has in France. They will give up Brie in the first moments of the battle, first moments of the campaign. They will lose their capability to build new weapons, wage the sort of war that we are going to see and that they really should have expected to see. But they're really thinking short war, and there's the evidence for it right there. It's also up further up here. They just abandon Lille, make very little effort to defend Lille. Lille is where all their coal is. So in the first battles, they're giving up their iron ore, and they're giving up their coal. Joffre later says that he never ruled out the possibility of a long war, and that he never said it would be a short war. He gave up, however, the Brie Basin, and he gave up the Lille Basin with virtually no effort to defend it at all. Let's look at intelligence for a moment. That's the same slide I showed you earlier. Really, by August the 7th, while this is going on, the French know where all of the German active corps are, except 5 of them. They don't know where 5 corps are. They do not count the reserve corps, even though they had gotten a copy of the German mobilization plan, and that mobilization plan said reserve corps will be used the same as active corps. The French did not believe that. They did not believe a reserve corps had the combat power of an active corps. So ultimately, all of their counting is not going to work out. If you look at their intelligence assessments and look at how they put them together, they're always counting corps. And they're counting corps to figure out what the Germans are going to do. When they launch this offensive by the 1st and 2nd Armies on the right, the 9th of the 14th, 1st and 2nd Armies are charging ahead, about to take horrendous casualties. They conclude the Germans are going to drive as deep as Givet. Remember, Givet is out in the west, sort of at the opening of the Chimay Gap. Then, on the 19th, they conclude the Germans have significant forces in the Liège area. The French look at this and say, great. We got them right where we want them. Joffre himself uses the analogy of a fist on an arm. With this arm coming across Belgium, his idea is to launch his offensive here in the soft underarm area. He really thinks that all the active forces are out here on the tip, going as deep as Givet. He thinks that what they will do is hit this soft underarm area, then pivot to the west, and then basically destroy the active forces out there. Now, that might have worked had they counted, had the reserve corps not been involved. But when the 1st and 2nd Army go into Alsace, when the 3rd and 4th go into Belgium, they're going to encounter significant resistance, to say the least. Let's look at that. This is, a map from the West Point Atlas series. This is the eastern portion. This comes all the way from 4th Army down to the boundary of 1st Army. Belfort is here. The first thing they're going to do is attack here in Belfort. They'll put General Powell down here in command of what they call the Army of Alsace, basically a corps, mostly reserve forces. They'll go charging into Mulhouse on 7th of August. One regimental commander is going to be riding a very fine white horse charging forward in this, and the Germans are going to do him the indignity of shooting him off his horse. Germans rapidly counterattack and drive them back. Up here in 1st Army and in 2nd Army, they're going to charge into Alsace, and their experience is going to be just as bad as the experience down here. When Joffre was the first appointed the chief of the general staff, chef d'état-major in the French Army, one of the things that they looked at was artillery, whether or not they needed heavy artillery. And Joffre is the one who says, we shouldn't put heavy artillery in our corps size units. It should be outside the corps. We want our corps to be highly mobile. We want our corps to be able to move quickly. We don't want to burden them with heavy artillery. They will buy some limited amounts of heavy artillery, and that most of that will arrive after the war has started. So these corps will charge forward. They will take horrendous casualties, and in no time at all, the Germans drive them back behind their starting line. Up here, Joffre is going to break up 3rd Army, going to make part of it the Army of Lorraine, put General Malnoury in charge of that, and then 3rd Army and 4th Army are going to charge into Belgium. These offensives are even worse in terms of how they're managed than the ones down here by 1st and 2nd Army. General Ruffy gets troops up near Virton, Longvie, but they're driven back with heavy casualties. One of the most disastrous battles occurs here south of Neufchâteau at a place called Rossignol. If you go by there today, there are signs and guides in that area. The 3rd Colonial Division will lead one attack against Rossignol, a bayonet charge. That will fail. They will do another bayonet charge, and then other bayonet charges will follow that. The Germans are not in entrenchments, as you would see in 1915 or 1916, but they are in prepared defensive positions in the sense that they knew the French were coming. They take some cover. The French soldiers charging them do not have any cover at all. That 3rd Colonial Division, which has about 15 or 16,000 soldiers, will take 10,500 casualties. So this is just a disaster for the French, and they are driven back. But about the time that they come rolling back on the 23rd, it's very clear to Joffre that the real threat is coming deep. He still thinks that deep threat is going to be around Givet. This is farther out. It's a 5th Army has moved from down here up into the angle of the Meuse and Sambre rivers. They have nothing on their flank. This is commanded by General Landrezac, does not get along well with Joffre. They have a particularly outstanding corps commander, Franche Desperet, who will perform superbly here. General Landrezac will complain about having to go into Belgium as far. He will object particularly violently when Joffre orders him across the river, because Joffre now believes that the main attack is coming north of the river. Essentially, Landrezac refuses. Then he is attacked on his flank by the German 3rd Army, and they come reeling out of Belgium very, very quickly. Farther over here is the British. Landrezac absolutely despises the British. He has a terrible relationship with the British. And this whole flank is beginning to come apart very, very quickly. Again, this is Givet. This is the junction of the Sambre and Meuse rivers. The 5th Army has gone up in here. They come reeling back. The BEF has gone as far as Mons, and then they are driven back. Someone else will have to speak to that. But Joffre begins to put French troops on the left flank. He begins to move forces from the right flank to the left flank. The 23rd of July is important because that's when, August, because that's when Namur falls On that day, the Germans see things going so well that they will take 2.5 corps and move them to the eastern front. Don't know what those 2.5 corps would have done in the long-term effects of this campaign, but I'm sure they could have contributed a lot. As Moltke is moving forces away from this area and thinking that they have the French where they want them, driving them back, Joffre begins moving his forces from right to left. General Malnoury's army will soon assemble on the left over here. If you gave Joffre a grade for the Battle of the Frontiers, I mean, if you gave him anything better than an F, you'd have to do it on imagination. It's a disaster. It's a disaster in terms of what they did, disaster how they responded. But now, as we go to the Battle of the Marne, suddenly, some of the things that Joffre has done, such as create light corps without lots of heavy artillery, those corps can be moved. They can be moved rapidly where they need to be. That becomes part of his key. He also very early recognizes that what they want to do is come around the flank of the Germans, come around the flank of the Germans. This is a larger portrayal of that. This is Verdun. This is Luxembourg. Here is Givet. A Fifth Army has come out of all the way from here back to here. Landrezac is having all sorts of problems with Sir John French. Does not like Sir John French. Does not have high regard for the British. That regard is even lessened when Sir John French decides basically to leave the battlefield, to back out and come back here somewhere southwest of Paris for a rest. That's going to open a huge hole in French lines. Joffre's movement of troops from his right helps form this Foch detachment that will become the Ninth Army under Foch. But he also is putting forces out here on the left with the idea of falling on the left flank of the Germans. This is the next step of the battle. If you look at the name of the commanders, Sorel is now commanding the Third Army. He has relieved Ruffy. He has relieved, he being Joffre, he has relieved Landrezac and replaced him with Franche d'Esperey. He relieves 10 corps commanders. That's half his corps commanders. He relieves 38 division commanders. They don't perform the way he wants them to perform. They do not respond to his orders as quickly as he wants them to respond. And he does all of this while the French army is really coming back from this area in here all the way back here. Think of that Fifth Army. They've really come from this area up to here, and now they're coming all the way back to this point. Foch now commands an army. The difference between his detachment and army is name. He has a few more troops, but not many more. The key to this really is when the Germans decide to pass to the right of Paris. Somebody else can give you more detail on that. The French learn about that because a British aircraft spies it, reports it. The French do not accept it as being the gospel. They send their own aircraft out to corroborate it. Then they see another opportunity on the left flank. And the idea would be to build forces here in Paris, around Paris, and as the Germans come around, then attack them on the flank. As you know, this becomes very controversial because the people who are Gallieni favors, are proponents, say that Gallieni came up with the idea of attacking the flank. In fact, that was Joffre's idea, really the general staff's idea. The supporters of Gallieni also point out that Gallieni argued to move up the date of the attack on the German flank by one day. Ultimately, it turns out that's not going to make much of a difference because the Germans will spy what they're doing and then try to adjust to that presence. The French will delay all the way down to here with the BEF and with the 5th Army, and then when they are ordered forward, they go slowly with the emphasis on very, very slowly. The troops that come out of Paris don't do much at all other than get the attention of the German high command. And that opening is what forces the Germans to change their campaign in the sense of what they are going to do. Meanwhile, there are some bitter fighting down here. The Germans really try to penetrate this area because they recognize the opportunity that even if this is opening, if they can drive through here, they will again have the French against the wall. You know the story as well as I do. The Germans decide to pull back. The Germans will pull back to this line, which becomes pretty much the line for much of World War I, and then the French will try to turn their flank. French soldiers are exhausted. As I said, the Fifth Army has gone from here up to here, back here, and now forward again. The French are going to try to turn their flanks, are not successful, still relying on the railway, still using the railway, but ultimately they are unsuccessful. There was a huge debate after the war about who won the battle. Was it Gallieni? Was it Joffre? Was it the British? Who in fact won this war? French erect a monument after the war right here at a little village called Mondemont. They build a monument that to them shows what happened in this battle. This is Paris. This is the Marne River. This is where the French and Germans were located, blue and red, on 5 September. This is Foch's 9th Army. Foch is able to keep the Germans from penetrating. And after the war, they build this big, huge monument to the victory of the Marne. I apologize for this photograph. The day my wife and I went to see this monument, the sun was exactly wrong. When I tried to take a picture of it, it was in the camera, so I had to go to the side, and you really can't tell what it is. But Winged Victory is at the top of this, I think it's 33-meter tall monument. But the key part of the monument is at the base. I don't know if you can see that. This is Joffre. This is the poilu. Poilu is French for grunt, the soldier. The French people, the French commanders were convinced that it was the French soldier who really won this battle. Just think of where the Fifth Army was. And on either side of Joffre, you can see the commanders all the way from his far right. That's Sorel. Can't even see them myself. That's Sorel, then de Langle-de-Carry, then Foch, Joffre, the Poilu. Over here you get Franche d'Esperey, Sir John French. Then ultimately you're going to come to Mallory and then Gallieni. You may be able to see it a little better in this force. Yeah, okay. This suggests the French interpretation of this battle. Joffre is the victor of the Battle of the Marne, but the Poilu is really the one who won this battle. You think about those soldiers who marched all the way into Belgium, marched all the way back, then I wouldn't say turned on a dime, but turned and then went back into the counterattack. That was an extraordinary event. But notice that Joffre is taller than the Poilu. Joffre really is the victor of the Marne. He's not the victor of the Battle of the Frontiers. But if you compare Joffre to the other commanders at this time, Sir John French, Moltke, the Grand Duke, Conrad von Hertzendorf, I mean, he looks like a shining star in comparison to them, to say the least. He, in fact, engineered the idea of attacking the flank of the Germans. The Germans opened their flank to him. He was the one who knew the railways and ensured his staff could use the railways in a successful way. So he really is the victor of the Marne. He's not the victor of the Battle of the Frontiers. Now, after the war, Joffre will retire to a little village called Louveciennes. My wife and I went up there one day to visit this. And, you know, it's not a public place. We just drove down the driveway and stopped here. this is the Jeffersonian style mansion. It's west of Paris, located on a hill so they can look down on the Seine. A gentleman came out as we drove up and said, "What are you doing here?" And I said, "Oh, I want to see General Joffre's tomb. His tomb is here." And he said, "Okay," and allowed us to do that. I should add that when Joffre lived in that mansion, he, at the end of some days, he would go downhill to the local village and play baccarat with the veterans of World War I. So he didn't become a hermit in any way. He did write his memoirs. He did have an office in the École de Guerre, but he certainly had very little influence over French defense policy. This is his tomb. Also buried with him here is his wife, Henriette, his daughter, and her daughter's husband. Now, that's a complex story, and it suggests sort of at the end how complex this guy, Joffre, really is. His wife, Henriette, was married when he first started dating her. He came back as the hero of Timbuktu, started dating Henriette. Henriette got pregnant. Henriette stayed married to her husband. The daughter they had is the daughter that's here. All the birth records show Henriette's husband at that time as the father, not Joffre. But when Joffre was asked about his daughter, he would always say, "She's a Plaz." Plaz was the maiden name of his mother. So this man, Joffre, is much more complex than we normally would think. He didn't think through his stomach. He made some terrible errors. Not attempting to keep Brie is one of those. Whether or not they could keep it is a different question. But not even making an attempt to keep it. He launched those offenses even though he had intelligence coming in suggesting the Germans were doing something a bit different from what he expected. And ultimately, he's going to read the Germans completely wrong in that battle of Frontier. But when you come to the Battle of the Marne, in terms of his recognizing the need to go around their flank, when you come to his ability to move forces from his right to his left, when you come to his ability to keep his calm, Moltke basically will suffer a breakdown during the 1914 campaign. Joffre does not. Now, Joffre is an interesting guy also in that he did not like to talk to people personally when he was making a decision. He liked for his staff to come to him with written memoranda recommending something, and he would read that and then make a decision on it. He had to function different from that in this campaign in the sense that he had to use the telephone. He absolutely abhorred the use of a telephone, but he used the telephone. He talked to his commanders. He actually went down to meet with Landrezac. He met with Ruffy. He met with Sir John French in the famous exchange where it says, "Monsieur le Maréchal, the honor of England is at stake." He's a complex individual. But ultimately, he is responsible not only for the hundreds of thousands of casualties that France suffered in August, September 1914, but also for the victory of the Marne. Any questions? Okay.
Again, we invite you to come down to either of the side microphones. And as soon as this one starts working, as it is right now, we'll start with this gentleman right here.
Bob, I'd like to go back to the two slides you showed about Plan 17 as a deployment plan.
Okay.
And then the actual movement of the army. When did the decision get made to plug 4th Army into that position numerically between the 3rd and 5th Army?
Yep.
And why did they choose that place for the floating army?
The decision was made on the 2nd or 3rd of August. And by that time, the Germans had violated Luxembourg neutrality. They had violated Belgian neutrality. So there was some evidence that, in fact, they were coming in that direction. It's a very clear indication from their perspective that the Germans really are coming in that that direction. But he will order them in that spot because that's one of the options. If 4th Army is put in the line, it will go to the left of 3rd Army, or it will go to the left of 2nd Army. So those were deployments that they, I don't know if they'd actually walked the ground on them, but they certainly discussed them. Joffre met with his army commanders during peacetime to discuss different aspects of this. And the most famous encounter is with General Dubail, who's the 1st Army commander. He's one down here in this this area. Dubail is briefing him on what he can do, what he should do, and he tells Joffre, General, I don't have the troops to do the things that you have told me to do. And Joffre comes back with, General Dubail, that's your plan, it's not mine. He would not even tell his army commanders what he intended to do. Reason for that's very clear. The moment he did that, somebody was going to find out about it. Somebody was going to know what he was going to do, and his ability to shape the outcome was much less. Does that answer your question?
Our last question is going to come from Tom Christensen.
Sir, I have one question. How much joint planning was done between the French and English staffs, if any, and did they have any idea about this whole offensive idea of Joffre?
I don't know how much the British knew about the French. I know how much the French knew about the British. When the French look at their allies, the ally they treasure most of all is Russia. They always come back to Russia. When they move up for concentrating at the beginning of this, they still don't know if the British are coming. They are reassured when they get the word that the British are coming. But throughout the planning that you see in the General Staff, if you go through their papers, you will find little blocks with a W on it. That's the British, and the W is for General Wilson. They couldn't write Britain on there, but they could put the W because of the coordination that Wilson had done. Basically, Wilson had committed the British to do more than the political leaders had agreed that Britain would do. The subject of the British comes up in the discussions with the Russians because on several of the briefings that Joffre gives to the chief of the General Staff in the Russian Army, Joffre will say the British will be here, the British will be on our left. He's not really sure when they're going to be there, not sure what they're going to come with. Supposedly 6 divisions. They show up with what, 4 plus? So it's really a major question for them. The ally for France is Russia. It always comes back to Russia.
Thank you very much. Join me.